All right. Welcome once again.
I told you I wanted to wear that dress. Why? Why do you do this to me? I'll never make out.
Well, let's introduce our candidates tonight, Ed. We'll introduce them out, and before we get started, we'll have a few words from you. Our first candidate, randomly drawn from a hat, we're going to have on the left is Rocky Del Fuente of the an independent of the Reform and Delta America Party. Welcome, Rocky, please, to our stage. Woo! Welcome.
I voted for you 100 times.
Only 100?
Well, I ran out of pencils.
Well, 101 is going to be the best one.
All right.
Thank you.
And we have with us Gloria LaRiva, Party for Socialism and Liberation. Please welcome Gloria to our stage. And Mr. Darrell Castle of the Constitution Party. Please shake or clap your hands for Darrell. Well, we're going to get started with our debate, but before we do, if the candidates don't mind, I would love for Ed to have a few words, and then I'll go through the format, and we'll get started. So, Ed, please say hello to Boulder, Colorado, Macky Auditorium.
I feel stronger each moment. I feel like a stone crashing down the mountain. I was greeted by a most beautiful day here today, and I thank you for the lovely sight that filled my eyes. I'm honored to be here. I'm honored to be at this assemblage to talk about the freedom and peace that this country seeks, or says it seeks, but has not delivered fully in any way, shape, or form. Our candidates tonight, hopefully, will show us the way to achieve some of those goals. I hope so. I hope by your questioning that we further those goals and find out more information. I hope to become educated here tonight, as I'm sure you and your questions and these candidates will enlighten me. I thank you for having me.
I also want to give a strong shout out to the student a cappella group One Note Stand.
That was lovely.
Wow. I mean, they have been very supportive behind the scenes. Chandler, Dylan, Robinson, Ruitt, the whole. And I mean, I felt when I listened to the national anthem for the first time in a very long time, I felt as if I could sing with them and be a part of that and believe. And so thank you again, One Note Stand. And so we're going to go ahead and get started with our presidential debate. What do you think, Ed? Should we
now,
do that?
What kind of time are you keeping? Are you keeping time?
Yes, we have a timekeeper out in the crowd. Candidates, on the left there, you're going to see when we're at 1 minute, 30 seconds, stop. There's a timekeeper
okay.
on the left.
Very good.
And we'll keep our eyes on that.
And how do you want to do these questions that we have in our little mitt?
Well, let me start off with the format. We're going to use the cumulative format. It's created by the League of Women Voters. It's the same format we used in 2008, 2012. After a brief introduction by the moderators, each candidate will have an opportunity to make an opening statement of 2 minutes. The order of the statements will be determined at random, which we did prior to this debate, drawing names randomly from a hat, left, right. There will be up to 9 questions in total. The questions will be submitted by free and equal sponsors, such as isidewith.com, you guys rock. Social media followers and locals, and you know we're definitely going to have a student up here from One Note Stand ask a question too. I think it's important to have a student engagement. The candidates will have 2 minutes to answer each question. Each candidate will have a total of three opportunities to take 1 extra minute to offer a rebuttal or typically expand upon their previous answer. So, for example, throughout your entire debate, you can have a rebuttal expansion up to 3 times. You can, for instance, you can use your extra minute on each of the first three questions, or you could choose to save them for the last three questions. You may use any of your extra minutes on the same question after each candidate has had an opportunity to use one to encourage a free exchange of ideas. And then each candidate will close with a two-minute statement. So let's get started. All right.
All right, I drew the short straw, so I'll be asking the first question. Where's my throat spray, by the way? The question is...
Are we going with questions, or are we going to do the opening statement?
We're going to definitely do a two-minute opening statement.
Okay.
My error, I apologize, Rocky. This happened in 2012 as well. Larry King, same thing. Thank you, Rocky. So, opening statement, 2 minutes. Please go ahead, Rocky.
Ladies first.
We'll start from the left to the right for opening statements.
I'm the right, so the left is over there.
We're going to start with you, Rocky.
Your left, my right. Okay, mm-hmm. Got it. Hi, I'm happy to be in Colorado. I've been here for more than 45 years, coming to Colorado. Spend more Christmas and New Year's here than most. I love sports, love to ski. And you have the best skiing in the world. My name is Rocky Roque de la Fuente. My mother from Mexico, Monterrey. My father from Veracruz. I'm what Trump would call one of those guys that showed up one day and was born here. Pay a lot of taxes, generate a lot of jobs, create a lot of jobs. I work in 8 states and in 4 countries. That's my specialty. Know how to create jobs and infrastructure. And we do need a lot of jobs and a lot of infrastructure. I would like to thank Free and Equal for giving us this gorgeous opportunity. We're here in this gorgeous debate that's open to all of us. Some of you have not heard of Darrell. Maybe you have Gloria, but of course, maybe you have not heard of me. This is a good opportunity. And if it was fair, we would have had the opportunity to be able to be on the national debate. But we are here because we care. We care because we need election reform. We care because we want to make sure that your vote counts. I also would like to thank I Side With, which has given us the opportunity to be able to show this to the whole world. Hopefully 20, 30, 50 million people will hear this debate and understand that there's other candidates out there that might be better equipped to handle this beautiful job that everybody, it appears, to want. I want it because I want to make sure that we get jobs, education, and health. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rocky Del Fuente. We will go with Gloria LaRiva, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Christine Tobin, for organizing tonight's debate. And thank you to Ed Asner, who has been a spokesperson and advocate for so many progressive causes for so many years. And we really thank you for being here tonight and moderating the debate. My name is Gloria LaRiva, and I'm running for president as a socialist for the Party for Socialism and Liberation in Iowa, New Jersey, Louisiana, and Washington State, Colorado, New Mexico, and also for Peace and Freedom Party in California and for the Liberty Union Party in Iowa. I wish to say that, as we know, we live in the richest country in the world, but it's the richest for only one class, the millionaires and billionaires, the capitalists and the bankers, who have, in the last years, accumulated an obscene, unimaginable wealth, much of which is abroad in tax shelters, while half of the population is officially poor or near poor. And that's not me speaking, that's the federal government statistics. We must also include the millions of people who may be considered middle class, but who are living a very precarious existence because of student debt, because of the possibility of foreclosing on their homes, all kinds of problems, and always the problem of economic insecurity under capitalism. I am a socialist candidate, and I say that the only way that change has really ever taken place, progressive change in the United States, has been when the people have organized, mobilized, demanded, and fought for our rights. And therefore, I'm very, very happy to be a candidate this year in an unprecedented election when the majority of people, I believe, in this country do not want to vote for either Trump, who is poison, or Clinton, who is not the antidote to the poisonous, misogynist, bigoted positions of Trump. I believe that Hillary Clinton is an absolute warmonger, and therefore, beyond November 8th, we will be organizing across this country for the things that all people need.
Thank you, Gloria. Darrell Castle of the Constitution Party.
Well, I, like the other candidates, I thank Christina for inviting me. I thank her for our association for many years. I guess it goes back to 2008. That's the first time I can remember anyway, but I was in a debate at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas in 2008 that she organized, and when she called me and asked me to come, I was not about to say no, because I think this kind of thing is very, very important. Now, I love my country, and I have been fighting for it in one form or another, in one way or another, since about 1970. So for many years, sometimes in a peaceful way, sometimes in the way that it told me I had to fight. Right now, I believe that political power must be limited. That's my belief. I share that belief with the founders of this country. They recognized that political power had to be limited. Political power is simply the legalized privilege that government has of using brute force against anyone that it chooses. You and I, we do not have that privilege. If we own a restaurant, we can't go out on the street and bring people in by force, but the government can. The government tells you, if you do not buy what I'm selling, people with guns will show up at your home and put you in jail. That type of power must be limited, because no one can resist it. Anyone who wants it can't be trusted with it. And there are no exceptions to that, including me. That's why you, the people, must limit power. You must limit this government. My party and I believe that that limit should be the U.S. Constitution. We should limit government, limit political power by returning to the Constitution and to its limitations on government. Thank you.
Thank you for your opening statements. Ed, let's go ahead and start with our first question of the night.
Gladly, thank you. Question number one. I know that many people today, like myself, find it disturbing that mainstream media is not covering the issues most important to the American people, such as the efforts being led by Native Americans to protect our water sources from contamination, from pipeline spills, by protesting the pipeline being built in North Dakota. What is your perspective on the protests in North Dakota and the fact that media attempting to cover the protests have been arrested and charged with crimes for doing so?
Rocky, you'll start with the first question.
Well, first and foremost is, this is in North Dakota, and we're talking about the Sioux tribes. That is private land. That's a nation. The Indians should first and foremost have the right to decide what happens in their land. If the United States wants to put a pipe, they must negotiate with a private nation. They do not have the power to basically do that. Now, if they protest, the media wants to cover it, they should be allowed. These are special interests at its best. Dakotas needs jobs, and I'm 100% for jobs. And assuming this was a water pipe, and they were going to travel water, then technically, I'm positive that the Indians would support water, because that's what gives us life. But they're protesting because of maybe a potential oil spill that might damage the land. But assume for conversation's sake that we needed that, they need to find another way to build that pipe. But they cannot go through private land that that's part of a nation. It's almost like if the United States wanted to do something between here all the way to South America without not taking into consideration all those nations' rights.
Gloria LaRiva.
Yes, well, I'm proud to say that I was in Standing Rock Reservation in late August to be in solidarity with the people there and to participate in the activities of march to the Ground Zero. I believe that the Standing Rock struggle, which is really over 280 Native nations in this country and even beyond, is the most important environmental struggle that is standing not over for the rights of Native sovereignty and recovering of their land, not just honoring the treaties, but expanding the rights and land that they have lost. It is also an environmental struggle for all people, because water is more precious than oil. And the other is that even the government recognized on September 9, when it was forced to say we have to stop the construction for now until there's further discussion and studies, is that they even recognize that there has been abuse of the government's use of eminent domain. I also went to Iowa, where I'm also on the ballot, and met with people, farmers, whose land was declared the area for which the pipeline could be built, and people, farmers who have been arrested in resistance as well, that use of eminent domain should be used instead for the people to take over the land, the corporate land that has been lying fallow, so that people can grow food, and so that the Native people can have true sovereignty. I think that the struggle of Standing Rock is extremely important and something that neither the Democrat nor Republican candidate has said a word about. We also should nationalize the oil companies to change from fossil fuel use to that of renewable energy in this country. And Standing Rock is the symbol for all people.
Darrell Castle.
Well, it seems that there are several parts to this question as I try to remember them all. But my understanding is that this pipeline does not run through tribal lands. If I'm wrong about that, I apologize, but that's my understanding. It skirts tribal land, I believe. But there are several parts of this question. The first part is treatment of Native Americans in general. I would have to say that the reservation system and what I've seen of it is probably the best example of what socialism does to a people that I can think of in this world today. And something should be done about that. Another part of the question is how the media and protesters, demonstrators, and so forth are treated. And obviously, none of us believe that they should be treated the way they are and so forth. It's a clear violation of the First Amendment. But this is what's happening in our world today with the media, very controlled. Almost everything you see, hear, read, controlled by only a few corporations, four or five. And if you think about it, those four or five corporations controlled by their boards of directors, who in essence controlled by one person. That person on these various boards has a great deal to say about what you see, read, hear, and so forth. So to the pipeline itself, I'm in favor of energy independence for this country. We are very much upset about environmental problems caused by our efforts to extract energy from the ground, but we don't seem so upset about what it does to other countries when we have to buy it from them. We don't really care what they do to their land. I'm in favor of the pipeline in general, in a peaceful way, and not across tribal lands.
Thank you. We'll go with our second question. And
I would like to rebut.
Oh, sure. Please, yes. Go ahead, Gloria.
I have 1 minute, right? Yes. Well, I would like to say that with respect to whether it's private land or Native land, if you look specifically at that case, it was in the 1950s that thousands and thousands of acres of Standing Rock Sioux land was taken from the nation through which the pipeline is now planned. But also, It's a matter of the pipeline going through the Missouri and the Mississippi rivers, two of the most important waterways in our country. And if 400,000 barrels a day, if that pipeline were to break, which usually they are more likely to break, that will mean disaster for decades, if not centuries, for millions of people. And also, we must say that we have to stop fracking. My vice presidential candidate, Dennis Banks, has been virtually the whole time at Standing Rock. He is a proud member of the Anishinaabe Nation of Minnesota, and as he said, it is one nation standing at Standing Rock.
Rocky?
Yes. Oil. We fought in Iraq for oil. We fought in Iran for oil, Saudi Arabia. We're all for oil. And it's going to eventually be over in 50 to 100 years. Today we have with biomass, with corn, with sugarcane, we can manufacture our own oil supply and completely we get able to reuse it and we'll no longer have to bring it from the oil. We can get Dakota, Iowa, we can get everybody in the Delta with all that beautiful water from the rivers. We can become, and we no longer have to import oil. We no longer have to be oil dependent. We need to study alternative energies. Unfortunately, we don't need to study them anymore because today we can make biodiesel, ethanol, with no longer subsidies from the United States government. Thank you.
All right, we'll move on to our second question, and Gloria will answer it first. We'll alternate from first, second, third, in order. We've been promised transparency in government, yet when WikiLeaks comes out and threatens secrecy and calls for true transparency, some of the same officials that call for transparency appear to crack down on whistleblowers such as Julian Assange of WikiLeaks, Edward Snowden, Chelsea Manning, and others. What is your perspective on privacy, transparency, and whistleblowers? Gloria.
Well, I consider Chelsea Manning, Edward Snowden, and Julian Assange to be heroes for the people to reveal the crimes of the government in carrying out illegal wars of genocide in Iraq and other countries, and as well to shed light on the government secrecy, the surveillance, the massive surveillance, which only became known by what these individuals did for us in revealing the truth. They have risked imprisonment. Chelsea Manning is suffering now under a 35-year prison sentence. She must be freed and allowed to be given all the health care that she needs in the immediate sense, but must be freed. And we call for the end of the persecution of Edward Snowden and Julian Assange. It is incredible that that Julian Assange's internet access was cut off in Ecuador because of pressure from the U.S. government. We also call for the end of the NSA, the elimination of all the surveillance against people, the FBI, the CIA, all the police institutions that are enemies of the people and stand for the Pentagon's interests as well as the corporations.
Thank you. Darrell Castle.
Well, President Obama told us that he would have the most transparent presidency in American history. I think he's fallen a little bit short of that goal. And I agree with Gloria. I would call these three people heroes rather than traitors. I get that question from time to time. Is Mr. Snowden, Mr. Assange, Chelsea Manning, are they heroes or are they traitors? I have no problem calling them heroes. I'm all for what they did. I'm for bringing them home. I'm for giving them a pardon. Mr. Assange, as Gloria pointed out, is languishing in the Ecuadorian embassy in London. At least that's where we think he is. He hadn't been heard from for a while, as I understand it. But reportedly, the lady said, can't we just drone him? She says she doesn't remember that conversation, in fairness to her. But they are in danger, as she said, Chelsea Manning in prison. And the other two just in a very much nicer prison, but nevertheless confined. The whole concept of whistleblowers, we need to, it's too bad that what these people reveal to us even happened? How would we know about it without them? How would we know what we know about government? As government becomes more and more cynical, more and more corrupt, the people become less and less represented and less enamored with what they're seeing, and they won't change, but nothing ever happens. Neither of the two candidates in the mainstream parties will tell us that they will do anything for these people. So you have to look to us, I suppose, if you want something to be done for these people, especially Snowden and Assange, who really have been tremendous people. Thank you.
Rocky Del Fuente.
The Second Amendment. The Second Amendment protects us the right to bear arms. The whistleblowers protect us from our government. They protect us for us to know the truth. We were promised, just like Darrell mentioned 8 years ago, that this was going to be transparent, that this was going to be the most transparent administration. I've been waiting for 8 long years. And now we know here, the irony is what's happening today happens to be the whistleblowers, a WikiLeaks. And what's interesting is everybody's arguing, was it the Russians? Why did they penetrate the servers? Folks, let's be logical. Let's read the information within the emails. What does they say? What information are we learning from that? America, we need to wake up. We need to wake up, and thanks to the whistleblowers, they're teaching us the path to the future. They're teaching us the path that we need to be able to be protected. And just like the Second Amendment protects our guns rights. Somebody was talking? Okay. Just like the Second Amendment protects our gun rights, the whistleblowers will protect our future and will protect us, our liberties, from our own government. Thank you.
I am quite impressed what I could hear of what all of you said, and I am very impressed by all of your answers. I would just also add to this that this event has brought together, as they have never been to my knowledge, the 280 tribes that you speak of have been united. So there is a good downside to this, that perhaps from this, the 280 tribes will learn how to speak with one voice and show the muscle that the Indians have so for many centuries lacked. So congratulations to them. I certainly agree with Rocky that we have the alternative fuels and hope that science will give us those alternative energies. I'm also impressed that Nathaniel is not the Daniel, forgive me. Daryl, well, I'll get Castle at least, right, won't I? I am improperly prepared. I think it's stage fright. But I want to thank you for giving me a different and a fresh approach on your own. And I thank you for that. I thank you all. Now, take it away, Christina. Question three. Mm-hmm. Any further on question two?
No more rebuttals. All right, let's go to three.
Question three is this. The United States is home to 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the world's prisoners. We have more people in prison in the United States than any other country in the world, including China. There's a lot of documentation that concludes that the war on drugs has led to this mass incarceration. Our prison population has grown from 200,000 in 1970 to 2.3 million today. particularly affecting people of color. People have called this systemic institutionalized racism. If you were the president, what would you do about this institutionalized systemic racism?
Darrell?
Well, that's your term. I'm not sure I would use it. But I do think it's a horrible problem, and I do think the war on drugs fuels a lot of it. There are many things that fuel it, but in my view, the war on drugs should be stopped immediately. It's nothing but a total monstrosity and a disgrace, and has been for, what, now 50 years? What you declare war on, you get more of, generally speaking. So there are more drugs than ever, more addicts than ever, more prisoners than ever. It's immoral and a violation of liberty to imprison people for possession of one of these substances or another. I mean, I don't get it. Why do people think otherwise? But that's one problem that you could resolve much of our prison population and the incarceration problem in general by stopping the war on drugs and removing the criminal sanctions for such things. But at the same time, I also know that another problem with incarceration is federal mandatory sentencing. I can tell you this, as a lawyer, quite often the system works like this. A person is accused of a crime in state court, and the state prosecutor will tell that person, look, you can take your choice. You can plead guilty for 6 years, or we can transfer you into federal court where the minimum sentence is 20 years. Which do you choose? This is a terrible way to do things, but I can assure you that it's done quite often. You know, I don't know. I know that that there's only one way in my mind that this country can be racially reconciled. I long for that day. I really do. I'm a Christian, as probably you know, hopefully you know. And God told us that in the last days he would resolve this problem. He said that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. That's the only way, folks. It's the only way.
Thank you for that. Thank you. I appreciate that. And I would also venture to say that I have the very uneasy feeling that every time we declare war on something, as you pointed out, we tend to lose it or lose billions of dollars in pursuit of that war with no effective gain. So thank you for your answer. Rocky next.
Yes.
Interesting question. I'm the first Hispanic American to be on the ballot in 20 states. You will physically be able to write, not write, to do the little dark thing. In another 15 states, you will be able to write me. I'm a minority. I don't pretend to be a minority. I am one. Like other candidate, that she thinks she understands minority. She does not. And they're not present here because I have a lot of respect for the people that are here with us. But today, there's four more times that minorities, African Americans, Hispanics, Chinese, any minority will be arrested for marijuana abuse than whites. Four times more. They're six times more likely that they will be put in jail. But more importantly is what happens to our youth. Most youth, 17, 16 years of age, all of a sudden they're tried seven times more. They're tried for being adults. Folks, that's something fundamental wrong with our system. It's not fair and equal. At the same token, we now have private prisons. So now we have the private sector trying to save us money, which I believe I agree with that part of the statement. But now they're going to try to make sure we put more people in jail because they become their customers. We need to have a balance checks, folks. We have to stop. Prisoners equals profits. We need to find a way. We need to find a way to educate them. And not the way they get educated in jail, because those people that are there for immigration or for other crimes, when they come in, they're nice and innocent. But when they live, they came up with a different education, and that's not the one that I want to give to America.
Yes.
Love you.
First of all, I call for the immediate abolition of the death penalty across this country. And to that end, I have supported very actively in California Proposition 62, which would abolish the death penalty. It calls for automatic transfer to life imprisonment, which I oppose. People must have the right to appeal their cases. And also, but first of all, we must save people's lives and work for more justice reform. I call for the end of the cruel imprisonment practices in the prisons, including isolation cells, for the end of all the laws that, especially under the Clinton administration, but also goes back as far as Nixon. For example, under Clinton, the effective death penalty and anti-terrorism law that basically abolishes habeas corpus in the United States, an essential right of appeal for any defendant. To eliminate the Crime Omnibus Bill of 1994, all of these which created the mass imprisonment. I call for the end of the school-to-prison pipeline, which has led so many youth who have been maybe truant end up in juvenile and then eventually in prison. And to prevent crime with jobs, jobs, and jobs. If you don't have formal employment, you will engage in informal employment. You have to survive somehow. And I want to say something about the drug addiction, which has led to so much imprisonment, wrong imprisonment, because what people need is substance abuse treatment. And that is that the pharmaceuticals have engaged, they have spent $660 million to lobby in Congress against restrictions of their pushing as drug pushers, the medicines that have created a lot of addiction in recent years, which has become an epidemic across the country and has led to much, economic crime. The pharmaceuticals which produce the opioids and other kind of very addictive medicine. So I call, Clinton said that he made a mistake with these mass incarceration laws. I call for the reversal and the freedom of hundreds of thousands of inmates who should be freed now. And freedom for Leonard Peltier. Freedom for Mumia Abu-Jamal, freedom for Mutula Shakur and other prisoners, political prisoners in the United States.
Thank you, Gloria.
I'd just stick in this word, that as you enumerated, Rocky, the primary four times the number of convictions for non-whites, that maybe it is not a racial prejudice that exists, but a prejudice against the 99% who don't have anything. That maybe it's an economic club rather than a racial club.
It could be both, but at the same token, it also could be with part of education. If you do not treat these people, if you don't give them sports, if you don't give them education.
Is this a rebuttal?
I'll take it. Since
okay.
If you don't give them sports, if you don't give them education, if you give them a future, if you don't give them a job that they're able to afford to have a car, to be able to get a wife and have a kid, then all of a sudden, maybe it's disproportional. So it has to start with education. It has to have a job, and it has to start with jobs that pay well. And then we might not get those ratios. But if those ratios are that high, that means that the rules that we're working are not the right rules.
Thank you. We'll move on to question four, but I just had a little note here, with a note I took for myself that along with the mass incarceration epidemic, we have these for-profit prisons, that is, that use their profits to lobby against the legalization of marijuana, which is a drug that many of their prisoners are incarcerated for, so it does seem nonprofit prisons are unethical and maybe they shouldn't exist, but So moving on to question number four, we'll start with Rocky on here, taking turns. In the so-called mainstream debates put on by the Commission on Presidential Debates, we heard almost nothing about war in the Middle East. The war in Afghanistan has been going on for 15 years. What's your position on the wars in the Middle East?
First of all, you do not need to win a war or lose a war. Sometimes, like Syria and Russia, sometimes it's okay to have a stalemate. Nowhere in the Constitution does it say that the United States has to fight all these wars, the most unpopular war of Vietnam or the one for 15 years in Afghanistan. Nobody does it say. The Constitution says we have to defend. We're spending billions of dollars, trillions of dollars in fighting wars where people don't want us or they're not ready for us. People are not happy for us. Folks, we need to be logical. Look at our track record. We put dictators, we remove dictators. And we do not have a very good track record of picking those dictators. We need, folks, to have somebody that's logical, that's not going to press that button at the first moment he has an opportunity. And that's why we need a miracle. We need to have Hail Mary, like in football. Thank you.
Gloria, LaRiva.
Yes, I was in Iraq during the period of sanctions, which was really a genocidal U.S. total blockade of Iraq from the end of the Gulf War in 1991 all the way until the second U.S. invasion of Iraq in 2003. And in my three visits to Iraq, I saw literally thousands of people in the hospitals dying from lack of medicine, dying from parasites and other diseases caused by the U.S. blockade, and from hunger itself. Over a million people died, for example, under the term, the mandate of Bill Clinton, who enforced the sanctions. And of course, George Bush Sr. was responsible for the 43-day bombing that destroyed the whole civilian infrastructure, all for the oil, because Iraq had nationalized oil up until the U.S. invasion and the privatization, once again, of the oil. People don't know that Iraq had free health care, free education, had a very highly developed highway system and civilian infrastructure. Now we come to Libya in 2011. Hillary Clinton boasts that she pressured Obama to bomb Libya. What did she say when Gaddafi died? She said, "We came, we saw, he died," and then she laughed on TV. That country was a progressive nation that was calling for the unity of African nations against U.S. imperialism and other countries, and it's been destroyed. And now, Hillary Clinton wants a war, a direct U.S. bombing war against Syria. We say U.S. troops, U.S. bases, U.S. ships, all the U.S. military out of the Middle East, and in fact, everywhere around the world, including shutting down Guantanamo base and returning the territory to Cuba and freeing Puerto Rico from U.S. occupation. But I say U.S. out of the Middle East. That's the real road to peace. And that $38 billion gift that's been given to Israel in the next 10 years and stop the genocidal brutality against the Palestinian people. Long live Palestine.
Darrell Castle.
Well, I find myself agreeing with my socialist friend on a few things, not on all of them, but I agree with her that the people that start and fund and conduct these wars are despicably wicked, and that there's more to them than meets the eye. In Libya, for example, this invasion and destruction, as she pointed out, Gaddafi was doing a lot of things for the African people. He kind of reformed himself from his Pan Am days, but he wanted a Pan-African Congress and currency based on gold, which conveniently disappeared after he was executed. The gold in the Libyan vaults, no one knows what happened to it. In Syria, that's where we are now. Let's take Syria. We have some interest there, we're told. Mrs. Clinton, the other people on the debate, only 1 minute left and so much to talk about. I could go on about war all day. But, you know, we arm all these people, the Saudis, the Iranians. We make a deal with Iran so they can obtain nuclear weapons. And we complain, one side does. One side says it was a good deal, but we both complain about what they're doing in Syria. We arm everybody. We arm the Turks. We arm the Saudis, and they fight this proxy war. They've been fighting over our folks for 1,000 years. We've just given them something that they hate worse than each other. I'm getting to the point where I agree with Gloria, and that is that we should leave the Middle East. I,
I'm all in favor of it. I'm a mind your own business kind of guy. I believe in self-defense. I defend this country with my last drop of blood, which I've done before. But I see no interest of theirs there. All we're doing is creating enemies, causing more problems, killing more people. Every person that we kill has 250 friends. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. I would make one little posit here, and that is in 1960, President Eisenhower, a good Republican, made his last statement, which was, beware the military-industrial complex. And I think it's sad that nobody's taken up his words and used them, because it's bigger and more powerful than ever, as we see by the Middle East.
I'd like to use one of my one-minute rebuttals to agree with our moderator. If I may, is that okay? In 1960, when President Eisenhower gave his speech, he was welcoming President Kennedy, and he was talking. He gave the speech in terms of good luck out there, Jack. You know, it's not going to be easy for you. And President Kennedy took his words to heart, and he tried to do certain things about the military-industrial complex. For one, he had 1,000 advisors in Vietnam, and he was going to pull those out as soon as he was nominated. Two, he wanted to end the Federal Reserve. He actually issued silver-backed currency, which President Johnson withdrew the moment he was inaugurated. The other thing he said, I'm going to break the CIA into 1,000 pieces. Well, the CIA broke him. I'm no conspiracy theorist, let me be on record. But he learned his lesson, and I've read many times and heard it said that he was the last president who actually initiated his own policy. Everybody else just echoes the policies of other people. So there have been examples through the years. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you. Rock, you have one more rebuttal left. Gloria, two. And Darrell, you have two.
In 1960, I was 6 years old. So I do not know what happened, but I do know what happened in 1980 when I was 26. In 1980, we had a friend. It was Iran. Our country went there because of oil and created a big landslide. We destroyed Iran. We destroyed Iraq. We destroyed Kuwait. Now we destroyed Syria, Afghanistan. We have made a huge mess out of that issue, and we lost many American lives. Now we have 12 million illegals in this country. We're gonna, if we follow one of the favorites, candidates, he wants to deport all of them. We're gonna create the same problem we created in the Middle East in our own backyard, Mexico, Guatemala, Nicaragua, so forth and so on. Last thoughts, you mentioned Guantanamo. United States entered to a 100-year lease. 110 years ago, folks. They should have left there 10 years ago. They have not. And for what purpose? So they torture people? Thank you.
All right. Question number five. Question number five. Do you support the Trans-Pacific Partnership? Period.
Gloria.
Absolutely not. It is really NAFTA on steroids. And we should look back at what NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, did as one of the first major free trade contracts that has devastated not only the Mexican economy and forced millions of Mexicans to leave their homeland to the United States, but it also caused massive economic dislocation for American workers. It benefits the corporations, the banks, and the oil companies. The TPP was, of course, secretly discussed. The people don't really know what it entails completely, but it really makes the corporations the government. It denies any government that's part of the TPP to be able to protect its people with environmental laws, or even its own national economy. It's all for the benefit of the mass, the giant corporations of the United States, and we have to completely oppose it. It's incredible that it's the Obama administration that is the biggest proponent of TPP, and it just is one example of how when Obama became elected, it was of course historic for an African-American man to be elected. It was absolutely necessary in these more than 200 years of US presidency that a black man would be elected. But he was and is the CEO of the capitalist system, the most powerful, richest capitalist system in the world. And the TPP is another attempt of US imperialism to expand its global dominance and because capitalism must always expand or die, and that's the real intent of TPP. Hillary Clinton said she was against it. Let's see what happens if she becomes president.
Darrell, I won't make that mistake ever again. To my dying day, I'll know your name.
Well, please. I got that going for me, so thank you. Oh, is it my turn now? I'm sorry. Well, I find myself in a difficult position once again. I agree in large part with the socialists, which has never happened before. I do agree with what Gloria said up to a point, and I'll get there. TPP is simply the worst of the free trade. They get progressively worse as it goes down the line. She's absolutely right when she says it's there to serve corporate interests, multinational corporations from all over the world. It transfers American sovereignty into the hands of these corporations run by corporate boards and bureaucrats, totally unaccountable to the American people. People don't understand that. It's not about free trade. It's about transferring American trade sovereignty to corporations, both American and international, where our trade can be hauled in front of these various corporate courts run by corporations and by other bureaucrats around the world. So NAFTA, TPP, I'm against all of them. I'm not against free trade. In fact, I'm in favor of it. I believe it's done a lot to uplift people in all countries. In fact, for example, if you want to have a free trade deal with Chile, where it's winter there when it's summer here, and so we have different growing seasons. They sell us their fruits and vegetables that they grow during our winter, and every day the trucks show up at our grocery stores, and one day they won't show up and we'll all be terrified, but never mind that. We have this deal. They buy our aircraft parts and other machine parts that they can't make themselves. I'm all for that kind of deal because I think it's good to go to the American people and say your stuff's going to cost less if you elect me, not more. You will not be paying more for everything that you buy that you need to live and so forth. But the free trade agreements, President Obama, it doesn't surprise me. I mean, it's all part of the same globalist world corporate structure that we struggle against.
We have a trifecta. I agree with my partners, my candidates for president, and more importantly, now you see how three candidates can behave like candidates, mm-hmm. and not.
Yeah. As Rodney King said, why can't we all get along?
We need your advice and your wisdom. I hope you don't count those seconds against me. Thank you. In reference to free trade, I agree and disagree with my candidates. Number one, I'm 100% for free trade, for good trade, for the right trade, like you mentioned, like Chile. I'm 100%. We need jobs. We need momentum. We need goods. We need people working. We don't need wars. We do not need arms. We do not need more manufacturers of guns. We need free trade. What we do not like about the NAFTA is that was negotiated by whoever, and there was American was left out. The American workers were left out. What we don't like about the Trans-Pacific is the same thing happens. We are trans. If you read the agreement, if we do something wrong, their courts decide and we pay. So the question is, I support free trade, I support jobs, and I will always support both. But what we need to do is make sure that we get the right people negotiating those agreements. They do it for us. And make sure that it's open. Make sure that we had an opportunity to understand it. That we understand what the agreement basically says. And once we know what the agreement says, we might all be behind it. We might like to bring produce from Chile. We might like to produce automobiles from China. Who knows what we're gonna do? We might wanna send our corn and our sugar canes to produce biofuel to sell it to the world. We need free trade, folks, especially in America.
Above all, I think when we examine any trade deal, I think we should also find how many more Americans will be impoverished by it. And if there are too many to count, then I think we should fight it.
Yes, question number six. We'll start off with Darrell. Jimmy Carter said in the summer of 2015 that our country is no longer a democracy and that our government now functions as an oligarchy. A recent Princeton study shows that there's a zero chance that our federal representatives actually represent us when they go to Washington because they are so heavily influenced by donations from corporate and wealthy donors. What are the steps we need to take to reclaim our democracy, republic?
Well, that's a good question. And let me see if I can answer it. I would be remiss in my duties. I understand the word democracy to mean the right of the people to govern themselves, so I accept it on those terms. But there is too much money. I mean, why can't I have some money to campaign with? Why does it all go to the Democrats and Republicans? Why can they go to foreign countries and get billions of dollars? Why can they use the State Department as a slush fund for their own campaign contributions and so forth? I hope you understand I wouldn't do that if I could. But what steps do we need to take? You know, I can propose some steps, but as a simple test, I mean, my platform, my party's platform, opposes this kind of recommendation, and so I'm not officially recommending it. I'm just telling you that it's something that is worthy of looking at. Let's say that you had a certain set of rules that people could agree on, and candidates who meet that set of rules get $50 million of public money to campaign with, and they cannot solicit money in any other way. No one, not some poor grandmother that sends them $20 or some corporate executive who gives them millions. They can't accept any money like that. They only get the $50 million. And that could be based on access to the ballot or something like that. But the candidates who get this $50 million go out there. What would happen if Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, me, Gary Johnson, Jill Stein, Gloria, and Rocky, and you know, if we had $50 million to go out there and we go at it equally, all the same, you know, we use our money to the lady's trying to cut me off. But anyway, I'd like to have that chance. It's an interesting thought anyway.
Thank you. Rocky, Del Fuente.
Campaign reform. I agree with him 1,000%. We need to do it. If you go to the Olympics, you want to be able, you can compete in 10,000K or 100 meters. And you want to know that you're competing with people with the same rules and not that you have to wear a 20-pound or 30-pound shoes. Campaign reform is needed so bad. And we need it. He came up with an idea, which, by the way, I had not thought about it, but makes a lot of sense. Maybe some other people can come up with better ideas or a combination of ideas so we can have real campaign reform. But after campaign reform, we need to have election reform. We cannot have election fraud. This is going to be the dirtiest race in the history of the world. This is in 2016. That's the year the Democrats stole the race from Bernie. 2016 was the day they did not allow the Democrats to be able to run as a Democrat. Not only did they not allow you to participate in it because they built up walls, big, huge walls, not like the one Trump wants to build. They built walls bigger for people not to be able to participate. My candidates here are making it all the way to the ballot. I tried to run for the Democratic Party. I did not know they cheated, and they cheated very well. But at the same token, now that I know they cheat, you finally overcome it and you make it to the ballot. And you get to choose, because now we have campaign money to do so. And you are able to hear me. And what happens? They steal the votes. There was somebody outside said, follow your boat. Folks, we need to follow the boats. The question was, what are we going to do with all the politicians in Washington that are there today? The House of Representatives or the Senate? Fire them all, folks. They are not good for anything, because they are not working for you or for me. Thank you.
Gloria, yes, LaRiva, please.
Yes, there are certainly many things that could be done to reform the electoral system. Just talking about the electoral system, for example, overturn Citizens United decision of the Supreme Court, allowing the millions and millions of dollars to be funneled into the capitalist politicians' pockets. And certainly for easier access for third parties to the ballot, and to access to debates. But the word democracy is really an abstract term, and I want to get to the root of it. We live in a capitalist democracy where the corporate boss has the right to lay workers off to satisfy his or her bottom line and maximize profits. We live in a system where the landlord's right to profits prevails over the right of a person to a home. And I say that we need a people's democracy, really a socialist democracy, where all the wealth that the people create, whether it's building the homes and skyscrapers and bridges and highways, everything that we need for civilian life, the food, everything we produce should be shared by all, owning the means of production, owning the wealth that creates wealth. And so it will take a major struggle. You know, Bernie Sanders talked about a political revolution. I call for an economic, social, and political revolution. And it's the only way really to save the planet from the environmental destruction, which is accelerating quicker than ever. I call for the change of the political system by changing the economic system of capitalism to a socialist one, to a people's democracy.
Yeah. Ready? Okay. I just was practicing your name, that's all.
That's good.
I'm just not going to stop it.
Go right ahead and work on it.
Now, the next question. With reports of premiums going up and many of the big insurance companies pulling out of Obamacare, if you're elected president, what do you think should be done?
Rocky?
Obamacare, beautiful idea, beautiful thought, and no different than the people that like to cook. When you start cooking something, you have an idea, but by the time you got 10 cooks, it comes out wrong. Obamacare was a good idea, and it still is. Unfortunately, there were too many cooks. That's called Congress and senators. Today, it doesn't work. I would not scrap it. I believe 70% of Obamacare can be salvaged. But we need to bring it back to what's originally intended. We need to bring the cost of medicine down. We cannot afford to pay $100 for one small little blue pill. It's not fair. It is not fair for our system. It's not fair for the people that are paying for it. We can reduce 80% of the cost of medicine, because there's only 100 medicines that need to be reduced. The second thing, we need to lower the cost of our doctors. How do we do that? We make sure the malpractice insurance. We need to do a comprehensive effort. Malpractice insurance has to be in check. Lawyers have to be in check. What lawyers get has to be in check, because we're the ones paying for it. And if we put those two balances together with the cost of medicine, I believe, just like Mr. LaRiva believes, that we can have socialized medicine free for all of us. So when we get 70 or 80 or 86, we do not have to worry about what it's going to cost. If Canada can have socialized medicine, so can we. Thank you.
Gloria, LaRiva?
Yes. Yes, today the Department of Health and Human Services announced that the prices of health care plans will really skyrocket. It could go as high as 116% for the mid-level plan under the Affordable Care Act. 116%, 25% in Iowa, 40% in North Carolina. And the premise, the flaw, the fatal flaw in the Affordable Care Act was that it still allowed the health insurance companies, which I consider totally parasitic, they serve no purpose except to profit off of people's illness, it allowed them to charge whatever they wished for health care. And also, Obama's idea of putting an element of protection for lower income people, that was wiped out thanks to the corporate lobbyists. So rather than just fixing Obamacare, I think that we have to have a completely free and universal health care plan and system provided by the government. It's not really whether it's a small or big government, it's who the government serves. It must serve the people and every human's right to health care, including preventive care. I say also, in part of this, nationalize the pharmaceuticals, who have made trillions of dollars in gouging people, as Mr. De La Fuente said. And also make education free so that doctors, nurses, medical staff doesn't have to go into super debt and charge people for their services because of having to pay for their own education. Instead of spending $1 trillion on the Pentagon, use it for the people. And we could have so much care, including mental health care, unlimited mental health care. Many plans have such a limit for what people can have. And there is definitely a need for mental care, preventive care, and so on. And I wish to also make a point that the Republicans have also played a role in trying to destroy the progressive elements of the Affordable Care Act. They have put a stop on the trillions of dollars that is available to the health insurance companies for those who were losing money in the first years and providing care to people who were of low income. However, it still is allowing the health insurance companies to continue. I say abolish them.
Thank you. Darrell Castle.
Well, I finally found something I could make a, if you'll pardon the pun, radical departure from my socialist friend and even from Rocky. The purpose of health insurance is obviously to spread risk over the population. If you take 20% of the people who have catastrophic conditions that use up all the money, you spread it out over all of us so that when inevitably we're part of that 20%, it's all covered. Well, as they pointed out, it's not working. But about Obamacare, I agree with Bill Clinton. This may be one of the only things I've ever agreed with him about, but he said it's crazy. You take 25 million people who don't have insurance, and then you take all the rest, all those people who are out there busting it, is the term he used, 60 hours a week, and their coverage goes down and their costs go up. That's Obamacare in a nutshell. Now, I confess something to you. I'm not exactly certain what I would do about health care if I were president. I mean, I think I would assemble people to help me, people who knew something about health care, who knew something about what they were doing. I mean, I'm a capitalist and proud of it, so I would use the free market system to bring it about, attacking the six great things which cost the most, you know, heart disease, cancer, dementia, and elderly people. You know, we're one thing we all have in common, no matter what we do, if we take our vitamins and we exercise every day and we don't eat anything but grass and weeds, we're all going to get sick and die.
So we're all going to need health care. She just put the end to my my conversation. But anyway, folks, that's the way I see it.
Well, thank you. Any extensions? Okay. Gloria, please.
I'd like a one-minute rebuttal. It is the free market system, even with the restrictions, a small amount of restrictions on them, that has created the medical crisis for people. How many people suffer with not being able to go to the doctor or get dental care? So many people who only go at the last minute when it's an emergency. I've been to Cuba many times, which, as you know, it has free health care. And not only that, but quality health care, preventive health care, where every Cuban citizen has a right from birth to death to the best quality health care, neighborhood doctors, at a fraction of U.S. cost. And I wish to point out that there must be a complete overhaul of the system to provide health care, free health care for the people here, provided by the government. And people don't know that next year, 400,000 veterans will lose medical coverage next year. 400,000. Those aren't my statistics. Those are the statistics of the government, and it's a crime. And that's just one group of people. Millions still don't have any access to a doctor. And the millions who have medical insurance, what if you get laid off and you lose your coverage?
Thank you, Gloria. All right. All right, well, I'm excited about this question. I think it's important to have, of course, a lot of our questions have come from social media, the peopleisidewith.com. But now we have a student here at CU-Boulder. I've known probably almost a year now or so. Dylan Robinson-Ruitt of OneNote Stand, please welcome him. He has a question for the candidates. Please welcome Dylan.
So like Christina said, my name's Dylan. I'm a sophomore here at CU, and so this is a question that really affects every single student here at CU. What would you do about the student debt crisis and skyrocketing costs of tuition that students simply can't afford?
Okay. Thanks, Dylan. Appreciate it. Gloria, you're the first
yes,
one.
Yes, thank you so much for that question. And I believe that education should be completely free, of course. I think that it's a crime that students' debt is now $1.3 trillion, and an even greater crime that when the banks who created their own financial crisis that affected the whole population drove down our pensions, caused the foreclosure of 3 million homes, that they are continuing those practices, and they're continuing demanding the payment from students. Literally, a student can die in old age without being able to pay back their debt. And it's the only debt in this country that a student cannot declare bankruptcy on. Isn't that something? The universities, which are really corporations, have discovered this great gold mine in creating debt to students. I say this, I became a student at Brandeis University in 1972. Because of the students 4 years before me, black, Latino students who shut down the campus, like so many across this country, for affirmative action and ethnic studies and ending the Vietnam War. And I think it will take a student strike across this country. You all have the social media. You have the power as students. The workers have the power to shut down the workplace. The students have the power to shut down school until you win the right to a real education without a debt. You can walk to a corporation and say, I'm here ready to make you a profit, and I spent 4 years, a tenth of thousands of dollars in debt, and you didn't have to pay a penny for the profit that I'm going to make you. Think of the absurdity in this country. We live in the most capitalist country. You don't have to be socialist to have free education, but in our country, it's getting more expensive. So I urge the student movement across the United States to think of those actions. Student strike, national student action to win your right, and to bail out the students and not the banks.
What Scandinavian country does not charge its students to go to college? Do you know that offhand?
I don't know. I think there's a lot of countries that have free public university.
I think it's either Sweden or Norway, one of the two.
Thank you. Thank you.
Darrell Castle.
Well, I've been a bankruptcy lawyer for 37 years, so I know a little bit about it. There are other things that are not dischargeable, but student loans certainly is one thing that is. The student debt crisis, as it's been called, is caused by government interference in education and thinking that's a good idea, period. If the government did not guarantee these loans, those loans would not happen. If the government didn't guarantee those loans, they would be dischargeable in bankruptcy. But the government makes the rules. As I tell clients every day, well, they'll ask me, well, why is it like this? I mean, why can't I discharge my IRS debt? I said, well, because the government makes the rules, and it makes it in their favor. You know, just like Democrats and Republicans make ballot access rules in their favor. Student debt should be dischargeable in bankruptcy like any other. People say, well, the government would be stiff for all this money. Well, it's being stiff now. You know, 15% of it, 200 million of them are in default right now as we speak. So you can't do it that way and still keep pouring it in the pipeline on the other end. Government guarantees of loans, in fact, government guarantees, period, should be stopped. Now, I guarantee you, if you do that, you'll see the cost of education tumble rapidly. You might see some of these billion-dollar playgrounds that are built across the country on our universities so that the alumni can be entertained. You might see some slowdown in some of that as well. You know, when I started to college in 1966 at a fine state institution in Tennessee, my tuition the first semester was $75. When I started the law school in 1970, 76, I think it was, my tuition was $243 the first semester. And the lady tells me that is the end of my opportunity. I've got a lot more things to say about education, but the relentless pressure of this woman on the front row is stopping me.
Rocky Del Fuente.
Gentlemen, ladies, students, we currently owe $19 trillion. By the time November 8th comes and you have the time to vote, it'll be $20 trillion. Now, how are we going to pay it back? The only way we're going to pay it back is first with education, second with the jobs, high-paying jobs, and third, making sure that those people that have the educated and they have the jobs, they had health care. Now, as far as the student loans, I propose something completely radical. I propose free internet, global free education, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Bring the best experts, the best teachers from all over the world, from Denmark, from Sweden, from China. Teach mathematics, teach physics, teach chemistry, teach medicine, or teach carpentry, or teach mechanics. We need to be able, because a lot of people cannot go to a four-year college. They don't have the time to do that. They do not have the time. The minorities do not have the time. So we would like to be able to study between 2 and 4 o'clock in the morning, Saturday and Sundays, because we need to be able to go get a job so we're able to go pay, get food for our families. So I propose the virtual reality university that will be the standard of the world, free for all Americans, 100%, and free internet up to 512K, so we would be able to take advantage of that university. At the same tokens, I don't want to get rid of the sports facilities or the universities like this good one. My future son-in-law graduated from this school, and he will be my son-in-law a year from now, so I hope you gave him a good education here. At the same token, what do we need? We need to have schools. We need to have where people can go interact. We need the brick and mortar so we can play sports and don't play Nintendo or play Pokemon or whatever the thing is. It's creating a lot of issues. Folks, we need to educate our people and we need to do it quick. Also, as far as the debt, folks, the first thing I would do as president, make sure that nobody has to pay for it because they did not get their money's worth.
Let's thank Dylan again for that question, for the one of Dan and his support and his whole team.
Do I have any rebuttals left?
You actually do. You have one left, and Darrell has two.
Okay.
Feel free.
I wish to add more about the issue of students and education. I don't think students should have to study and work. It's very, very hard already to go through education to make the best grade that you can and really learn while you're there. I think there can be an idea for online education, but I think that students should be able to have quality education in person, you know, free exchange with other students and with their professors. I believe that students should be subsidized not only to have free education, but the right to have an income while they go to school so they can study and do the best that they can. Students with children should have free childcare throughout their education. And I think we should consider students extremely valuable. They're not just the future, they are the present. And again, I think that debt and loans is unacceptable in the realm of education.
I got
Darrell, please, you have two left, so
yeah, I don't want to walk out of here with 2 minutes in my pocket. So I don't think education should be free, and I don't think it should be a lifetime of debt. That troubles me greatly to see that happen. I worked very, very hard, and I sacrificed to make sure that my daughter didn't face that. I have no problem with work. I've had a job since I was 9 years old, if you count paper route. I worked to get through undergraduate school and through law school. That was very possible then. You could easily have a part-time job and pay the $243 a semester that I paid. It's just now that it's not possible. It's no longer possible. It's not even an issue. You can't pay the massive tuition that kids have today. Something has to be done about the tuition. These huge edifices that you have, like right here at the University of Colorado with all these buildings and all the money that pours into it. Once again, the lady tells me I've got to stop. But something online could be done, it seems to me, to reduce the 100. I got it. Okay, I'm done.
I'll give her my minute. I'll give her my minute.
Well, you've got one more rebuttal left, so you could just use it again.
Well, I mean, are we done? Is that the last
question? We've got one more question.
We do? Well, I better wait then. You don't know what Gloria's going to say. I might have to, jump in.
I'll do this one.
What?
I'll do this question, yeah, this last one, because this question I'm really passionate about. It's, you know, currently we've heard from individuals with what's been happening with the Sanders campaign, Donald Trump, and so on. There's a lot of criticism regarding the current electoral process. And so I wanted to ask, what are some of the biggest issues you think that there are with our electoral process today? So, Darrell, please.
Well, the biggest issue that I faced this time, I decided when I got the Constitution Party's nomination, the people nominated me, the people in our party, that I would not beg and I would not pander. That was a principle that I held, and so I didn't. And as a result, my campaign, I would argue, has done more with less than most. But the problem that we face is that whatever funds we do have is quickly burned up in the effort to get ballot access. We struggle to get it, and ballot access is controlled completely, 100%. We say it like the ballot access, like it's all one word, but it's really access to the ballot so people can see us and vote for us if they choose. And that is controlled 100% by the Democrats and Republicans in the state legislatures across the country. All 50 states are controlled by Democrats and Republicans. They make the rules. They tell us how many signatures we have to get. 1 minute.
They tell us how many signatures we have to get. Like in my state of Tennessee, for example, they tell us we need 33,000 signatures to get on the ballot. Now, they not only set the rules, but they tell us which signatures are good and which signatures are not good. So to get those 33,000 signatures, you really need 50 or 60,000. Let's be conservative and take 50,000. The cost is about $3 per signature, in case you don't know. So that's $150,000. Access to the ballot is for sale, therefore. You don't need any people out. All you need is money. Now, they tell us, these Democrats and Republicans, they say you have to show a modicum of support, a modicum of support to get on the ballot. Well, how does having $150,000 in your pocket show any support? It doesn't. It's ridiculous. And that is the problem that we face across the country in every state. So you struggle to try to get ballot access, and then you have no money left to campaign with. Okay, all right, I'm done.
I just wanted to have a brief comment, Darrell, that ballot access is really close to my heart. This year, I have a petitioning company. I was inquired to help get an independent presidential candidate ballot by the name of Jim Webb when he was considering running. And what I learned is it takes over 900,000 signatures just to get on the ballot as an independent candidate, which means he would have had to collect over 1.6 million. That ballot drive on the low end would have cost 7 to 10 million. Depending on how close it got to deadlines, upwards of 20 million just to get on the ballot as an independent in all 50 states. So very, very rigged for sure. I feel for you, Darrell, and all the third parties out there, Greens, Libertarians, and so on, independents. And so, I mean, we all definitely can relate on that. So I just, that one's so to my heart. I just wanted to comment on that. So Rocky, please.
Well, I was stubborn once, I'm stubborn twice. I decided to run for the Democratic nomination. And there you too have to qualify to get on the ballot. I qualified in 40 states and 6 territories. And you have from the easiest rules, New Hampshire, to the worst rule, Georgia, South Carolina. You cannot get on the ballot even if you have a 500,000 people sign your name in Georgia or South Carolina, nor Florida for that matter. It's up to the party and or the Secretary of State to include you. So if they don't like Gloria, they don't like Darrell or Ed, you don't get in. Well, guess what? I managed to get in the ones I could, and by the times I did, I was out of money. So finally, I decide to run, and then they don't let you in the debates. So ballot access has to be fixed, and it has to be fair and equal. Interesting name, fair and equal to all of us that do. How stupid is this? In California, they reported 179,000 signatures. Texas, 79,000 petitions. Florida, 120,000. Darrell knows that he gets about $3. I had to pay close to $5. So in California, you need approximately 400,000 signatures. At $5, that's $2 million. Folks, one state, we got 50. Now Colorado, let's talk about today. You're gonna have 22 people on your ballot for the general election. Colorado makes it simple. You need to get 8 electors, 6 electors, and $1,000. Folks, I think that's a little bit too generous. And I think that allows 22. But I believe that a formula that can limit to 10 candidates per state, something that's fair and equal, should be the right thing to do all over the world, all over the United States.
I look forward to working with all of you, all that worthy endeavor. And Gloria, please.
Yes, I agree with my co-partners here in the debate about the lack of democracy in the electoral system. I would say essentially that it's a truly locked up system so that the two parties of capital really remain in power between them and share it in the Congress and the presidency and elsewhere in the lower offices. But let's talk about some things that could happen on reform in the current system. It's ridiculous to have to go state to state to get on the ballot. A party should be able to acquire national ballot status federally. It's a federal election.
We should be able to apply federally for whatever number of signatures are required. But the Democrats and Republicans don't have to go through the same process that the alternate parties do. And we're only alternative or third parties because that's what the system is. It's the two-party, one-party system. My party and the one that, the Party for Socialism and Liberation, the Peace and Freedom Party, which does have permanent ballot access in California, and the Liberty Union Party, we relied wholly on volunteer labor to get on the ballot, which also limited our ability. It's true, you need a lot of money. So I think those are some of the issues. Mr. Richard Winger, who is the editor of Ballot Access and is the supreme expert on ballot access, has pointed out in battling some of these states with excessive signature requirements that only 5,000 signatures in a state could give sufficient access to candidates, third-party candidates, and limit the what we see here in Colorado of something like 22 or 23 candidates. So, I think I can understand sometimes why so many people are on the ballot here in Colorado, because a lot of people are angry. An individual just said, $500, I'll get on the ballot so I have a voice. People feel like they have no voice in these elections. And to spend $1 billion to become president, or tens of millions to become senator, shows that it's really a system to make people feel like you had a vote, you had your say, now let us continue ruling over you.
Thank you. And the final rebuttal extension of the night, Darrell Castle.
Rocky said that he didn't know where I found my $3 gatherers. I guess I'm just a better negotiator than he is, despite the fact that he is a well-known businessman who spends his life negotiating and so forth. But no, what I found to be the case is that the closer it gets to the deadline, the more the cost goes up. You can usually get them for $3 if you get them early, but when they see you're within 2 weeks of the deadline, you still need 15,000, it's going to be like $5 or $6, or they're not going to work for you. Now, I'll give you an example. In Ohio, we really had no chance to get ballot access as a party, but we did have a chance to get ballot access as an independent candidate. We could get on in Ohio for 5,000 signatures as an independent candidate. So we submitted 8,900, which cost us a great deal because we had a few people there on already.
Give them one more minute.
Anyway, 8,900 signatures we submitted. Time really flies when you're having fun, folks. But they approved only 3,200 of them. They disapproved 5,000 of our signatures. So they, not only do they tell you need 5,000, but they tell you which ones are good and which ones are not good. And anyway, that's the way it worked out for us. In other states like that across the country. But you struggle, as Gloria pointed out, who spends $1 billion to get a job that pays $400,000 a year? But people do, they stand in line. We're there, we'd like to have that job. But we don't have the $1 billion to spend. If I had $1 billion, I'd probably just go out to my back porch and feel rich for a while. But people give them that money for a reason. They give them that money because they expect something. When they take money from foreign governments, they expect something from it. From the lobbyist shows up at their door, K Street, they expect something. They're there. How come so many lobbyists are ex-congressmen and senators? They know all these people, and they know how to deliver the goods for their clients. None of us can do that. Here's what they want from us. They want us, they resent us because we will not play their game. We will not get in their party and go through the long, arduous, lifetime struggle to be accepted and to gain stature and to say, okay, well, you're really worthy of this job. We might put you out here to run for state rep somewhere. And then if you were successful in that effort, then maybe someday you could run for governor. And then maybe if you're a successful governor and you're charismatic like Bill Clinton or somebody like that, maybe, just maybe, that's what they want.
But we're not willing to play that game, so they resent us and they try to destroy us as a result. Okay, I'm done.
Thank you so much. I'm getting messages from our Free and Equal National team out there that our Facebook reach alone for Free and Equal has gone from 100 to 200 to 300 to 400,000 plus. And there's been already over 20, 30, over 60,000 people have already viewed this debate and rising. So I just wanted to say that's pretty cool. So we're going to wrap up with closing statements here briefly, but just the electoral fraud, yes, the ballot access, the gerrymandering, the fact that we don't have alternative voting methods, the ballot access, the closed presidential debates, the mainstream media, the money in politics, and why is it that almost 100 countries have proportional representation? What's up with the Electoral College? So these are a lot of things that we're going to be discussing at our Electoral Reform Symposium here at CU-Boulder, November 19th, and I'm going to be welcoming all the candidates here to join that. So on that note, let's wrap up the debate with our final closing statement. Rocky, please, 2 minutes each.
I forgot to mention that I represent the Reform Party. That was the Ross Perot Party that was created in 1996. I was elected by them, and thanks to them, I got ballot access in Louisiana and in Florida. I also found that there are so many rules that I created the American Delta Party, and I'm in other states as the American Delta. And just like Darrell, I'm there also as an independent. It's hard to be able to keep so many balls up in the air. But I'm very proud to be here today with Ed, with Christina, and these two beautiful candidates. You saw some respect. They're presidential. I would be proud for them to be my president, not those two dumb and dumber that are trying to go for the job. Okay, you saw how the qualities in this, we treated like with respect. You thought it was gone, it's still here. There's five beautiful people in the podium. We did not attack, even though maybe we should, but we're here, we're proud. I would like to end. It's very difficult for me to say what I need to say in the 2 minutes. But if you can go to Rocky2016.com, please go there. Every issue you wanna know about, it's there. But more importantly, after you go there, if you agree with 80% of the issues, please give me the courtesy. Let me earn your vote. On the 20% that you don't agree, it's not negotiable. It is not negotiable. I will not bend for basically just because somebody wants me to go this way. I have my beliefs. I'm a Roman Catholic. I have my beliefs. I married a Muslim. I have my beliefs. I have five kids. And right now I have a 17-year-old that is now trying to qualify to go to university. And I got 15-year-olds coming on the way. Folks, I experienced your pain. And America needs so many things, including a flat tax system, and including health care, and so no haminian. So thank you very much, and please don't forget to go to Rocky2016.com.
Well said, Gloria, LaRiva.
Yes, we are living in a very, very critical time in our country, ruled by a government, as I've said, that serves only the interests of the capitalist class. And to the degree that there have been programs or benefits for the people, it has been when the people historically in the United States have organized, mobilized, and fought back, whether it was for union rights and the unions fighting for the rights of all people, or for the right of women to abortion rights that was won in the 1960s and 70s, women's rights. We still don't have full equality for women. We still are paid less than men. The civil rights era, which ended illegal Jim Crow segregation in the South, all of these things were because the people fought back and organized. And that's my message today, that on November 8th, and even before the 8th and after that, we have to join together all the people of this country, the working class, the poor, the undocumented as well. What people don't mention is that There are 5 million prisoners or ex-prisoners who do not have a right to vote. There are 15 million permanent residents in the United States who do not have the right to vote. My mother is one of them. She's from Mexico. There are 11 million undocumented workers. I dare Donald Trump to try to expel the Mexicans from this country and see how the food will just lie rotting in the fields, how the hotel rooms will remain unclean, how the restaurants will be there with people who want to eat but nobody to cook the food. The undocumented, the immigrant class, the immigrant people of this country are a valuable part of the working class. And what they did on May Day 2006, when millions went on strike, the largest demonstration ever in the history of the United States, is a sign of what's going to come. Occupy, Black Lives Matter, and all lives against police brutality. The fight for 15, you know, Trump says they just have to work harder, forget the raise in the minimum wage. Clinton said $12 maybe in a few years. But the workers, the low-wage workers, along with the union support, is what has made $15 an hour a possibility and a reality in some cities, and made it a very viable demand and a necessary one. So I urge people listening today to contact Gloria LaRiva for president.com is number 4. I'm not just a candidate. I'm an activist in a socialist party fighting for revolution in our country, which is what we really need. The Thank party you. For socialism and liberation, and the party, Peace and Freedom Party in California. Thank you.
Thank you, Gloria. And Mr. Darrell Castle.
Well, what I would say to those of you here in the audience, and those of you who may be on live stream out there somewhere, is that I too would like to see a revolution, a different one than what Gloria proposes. I would like to see enough of you people to go to the polls on November 8th or in early voting if you choose to do that, and vote for me. And then when I woke up on Wednesday morning, I would be president. And in effect, you would have effected a bloodless revolution, because the world would never be the same. It would be turned upside down. Now, just in closing, before the lady, I see her hands moving on the sign. She wants to raise it up there so badly to cut me off. If you believe that that those little people living in their mother's wombs are people, and therefore they are entitled to Fifth Amendment protection, as I do, then you might consider me. If you don't, any of the other candidates will do. If you believe that people should have the right to educate their children as they see fit, that it should be done on a state, local, and family level, as I do, then you might consider me. If you don't, if you think it should always be a federal matter, any of the other candidates will do. If you believe that that capitalism is the greatest system of prosperity for the most people ever devised in human history, as I do, then you might consider me. If you don't believe that, any of the other candidates will do just fine. If you believe that America should continue to poke its nose into every rattlesnake's nest that pops up around the world, and you sit by your television waiting for a war to occur somewhere, where the leaders of America say, hey, you know what, folks, why don't you just work that out yourselves? That one's on you. Then any of the other candidates will do. But if you believe we should come home, we should mind our own business, defend our own country, then you might consider me, folks. The lady says I have to stop now, so thank you very much.
We're going to wrap up our debate here, but Gloria passed me along a message, and I welcome all candidates, you know, a minute, if you would like, 30 seconds or a minute to comment on this, and I appreciate you bringing this over here, because I still am very puzzled by why this has happened. So Gloria, could you please?
Well, I just wanted to make the point that I really think that all the third-party candidates who were invited should have been present here today. It's, I think, a lack of respect to those of us all who have fought so hard in this electoral year to have a voice for the people, because we fight for the people. It's been a pleasure to be here with Mr. Castle and Mr. De La Fuente, and again to thank Mr. Asner and Ms. Tobin for hosting and moderating, and thank everybody who's here and those of you who are listening.
Darrell?
Well, I just echo what Gloria said. My socialist friend has hit the nail on the head. Shame on Jill Stein and Gary Johnson in particular for not coming. They are so high and mighty. They want to be Democrats and Republicans so badly. You know, Gary ran as a Republican and they totally, completely rejected him. He got nothing. And so he's, oh, well, I'm a Libertarian now. Jill Stein seems to me to be an honest woman. I don't have any criticism for her, really. I mean, I don't know her. I've never met her, but I know the Green Party representative in the state of Tennessee, and I know that she is a fine, honorable, and decent woman. I'm proud to call her a friend. Hope she feels the same way about me, but they should be here to help all. As she said, it's a common struggle that we have to raise up third parties and give the people of America another choice, but they're afraid of us. They're afraid to come out and get down on the same level with people like us. So I resent that too. I share her feelings.
Actions speak louder than words. We're here. We deserve you to look at us and consider us. I wish the other third-party candidates that have suffered as much as we have were here. They thought they did not deserve this attention. They'll regret it. Why? Because 100 million people will see this, and social media will make sure we get there. But now what do we need? We need a Hail Mary. Yesterday, 27-7, Broncos won. They needed four Hail Marys. We need a Hail Mary because we cannot have the two candidates that are being tossed us by the press. I sincerely feel we need to throw a third solution, and that is so Mr. Trump or Ms. Clinton does not get to 270 electoral votes. And the way we can do that is by unifying the third party. If all of a sudden, for example, we allow New Mexico go to Gloria, she's from New Mexico. If we would allow Iowa or South Dakota or North Dakota to Gloria, and we allow Darrell to basically win two or three states, maybe we allow Gary to win Arizona, and maybe we allow Evan to win Utah. I know Darrell wants Utah, but at this point, maybe we cannot be selfish. Maybe I can win Nevada. Maybe I can win Montana and Alaska. What would happen is that we will not get stuck with Trump or Hillary. And folks, that's a long shot, huge long shot, but it's the Hail Mary we need that sometimes wins a ball game. Thank you.
I would wish to say that all third party candidates should have been present, should have been. But in a way, I think it's a blessing. You can say that Christina, through her wiles, was able to weed them away from here, and that the three candidates we were presented with tonight have stood 10 feet tall, each of them. They have spoken eloquently, they have spoken sensibly, none too radically, and I have learned a great deal tonight. And above all, I'm going to get a hearing aid, so that should make all of you very much happier. Darrell Castle, how could I forget? You'll be first on the ballot. I have had a marvelous night here tonight, and I just want to say that though you may have been lonely out there, this woman has worked her buns off trying to make this an outstanding occasion. She has talked to everybody, sought out everybody, including those third-party candidates. And Though you may feel alone out there, you certainly have impressed me by your presence, and I know that the candidates here certainly were emboldened by your presence. I am delighted to have been in Boulder. I'm delighted to be with you. And I hope to come back and celebrate to a rousing, and I hope you get your wish of individual states going for you. That would be a lovely, delicious treat to stuff it in their face, because it's a criminal process that we have in terms of electing here. And for once, I would love to see it stymied, to see people, the people, nominate candidates who mean something to them, and who the people mean something to them. I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your votes. And I thank you for supporting these three people. My pleasure, and I thank you.
I wanted to, first of all, thank the three candidates here today that I find to be accountable and brave. They're brave, they're here for the people, and politics aside, I love what you're doing for our country. You're serving our country. It's a duty to get involved, and what these three individuals have done and the people in their lives, they've sacrificed a lot to be here today for such a worthy endeavor. So thank you, Rocky, Gloria, and Darrell.
They gave this election dignity.
And of course, I want to thank Mr. Ed Asner tonight for being here. Ed and I were recently, yes. Ed and I were recently at the headquarters of Free and Equal Elections, Cambria, California. And Ed came and co-moderated a candidates forum with me in Cambria, just south of Big Sur. And as an organizer, my role is to bring, I love bringing people together. And now we have 7, 8 candidates running for the local water board, which controls everything in Cambria, and most of them are accountable. And so that goes to show it's important to lead by example, get involved, because even though this is a national organization, Free and Equal takes very strong action towards getting involved, at least myself as an individual, in local elections. I want to also, huge thanks to the whole Free and Equal team out there listening to that live stream. You guys are rocking it. Let's clap for them. We would not be here today. Devoting hours, countless hours, and making this whole thing happen. Our production team of Stony Hill Studios and Real Politics, and I mean, just, and all the individuals, the sponsors I mentioned before, and supporters, you being out here today. And I wanted to end on a little bit of a different note. I wanted to read a passage from somebody that's been a huge inspiration in my life as a friend and soul sister, and inspiration for her words, a few paragraphs here, if I may. My heart longs for care and cooperation, for harmony, grace, love, support, understanding, health, companionship, courage, curiosity, vision, sight with clear eyes, hope, abundance for all. Respect. It is us, the imagining shells of the great butterfly, that can see the way. We have the power and determination to pivot into peace, collaboration, and shared humanity. We are waking up to alternatives, channeling the future, cultivating beauty, and blossoming hope. We are not feeble. We are not passive. We have the power of choice. Who will win the conflict of consciousness, the worst of us, the most vile expression of our species or our shared humanity? If you have found yourself here, I invite you to rise up to the potency of yourself, your life, and your contribution to this time. I ask that you live in the enormity of your potential, big and bold, act in determination and pride, armed with conviction and hope. Let's ripple the essence of our vision, of our light, our possibility into every crevice of our lives. We can choose to effect change through cooperation, through shared respect, mobilization, communication, and investigation. In each breath, each step, and each moment, we are creating a place where love dominates fear, hope destroys oppression, and unity conquers separation. Love is strength, evolution is power. Let us dance the world awake. I love you all. Thank you very much for being here tonight. Have a great night, everyone. More voices and more choices. Thank you.